And we're live.
Hello and welcome back to another What the Hell Does Elvis Have to Do with Any of This Anyways? Episode of the First Time Watchers Podcast.
Because we like to watch.
Oh, nice. You snorting some coke there, Wally?
I'm not saying I'm not.
My name is Tim Costa.
I'm Romano De Silva.
And this is Walter Pitcher!
Oh boy, here we go. If you'd like to send feedback, you can always email us at firsttimewatchers@gmail.com. No feedback this week. Oh, no, actually, you know what? I should say DJ Valentine piped up on our Muppets Take Manhattan episode, and he said, now do the Great Muppet Caper, you cowards.
I'm in.
Of course. I'm in. I'm not sure I've seen that, to be honest with you.
I don't think I've seen it either. I can't recall it, at least.
It's good.
Well, you're biased there, Wally.
I am biased. I'm not gonna lie. I am very much biased, but it is good. You don't want to see Charles Grodin try to get with Miss Piggy.
That is a selling point. I will tell you that. do they do a better job of integrating Statler and Waldorf than they did in Manhattan?
Oh, it's a good question. It's been a while since I've seen it, so I remember I got clear scenes in my head, but I can't place Statler and Waldorf.
Not a good sign, Wally. Not a good sign. Yeah, that's one thing I didn't mention in Muppets Take Manhattan. I don't think the Statler and Waldorf, however you say it, scenes seemed rather forced. Kind of inserted, like they didn't know how to place them. You know what I mean? Did you feel that?
That's true. Yeah, that is true. But I mean, where they are used, it works pretty well. Like they're in Central Park, and they get to heckling Kermit the Frog and Miss Piggy.
What did you think, Romano, of them? Do you remember?
No, I remember them just kind of quickly, flowing by a scene. I don't even remember what the scene revolved around. I think it did feel like it had nothing to do with anything and was just kind of there. It was like remember these guys? They're the Muppets too.
Yeah, exactly. All right. Anyways, in this episode, we close out season one of 2021 by discussing the 1993 Tony Scott film True Romance. But before we get into that, it is time for Yay or Nay. This is the part of the show where we discuss what we have seen recently on our own. I will go first. Should I start with the good or the bad, guys? Good or the bad?
Start with the bad. We'll lead into the good.
Okay. Bad. Ed, we all saw this coming, guys, from the trailer that came out earlier this year, and that is Cruella, the Disney movie reimagining of Cruella de Vil with Emma Stone.
I did hear it was bad.
There was actually a lot of positive reaction from people about this movie and saying that it's not that bad. It's pretty good. It's actually kind of inspired. I like what's going on here. Ugh, guys, this movie. It sucks. I hated every single moment of this movie with every fiber of my being. It is flat. It's insipid. It's emotionless. It's a CGI mess. Nothing makes sense. The story, asinine. Every character is a hollow shell. The production design, the camera work, editing, all terrible. It's a sad sign when 20 seconds in, I wanted to turn it off. I hated every second of this movie. And you know what? Just because you're Disney and you can afford any song you want doesn't mean that you need to insert every popular song of the era. It takes place in the 60s or 70s or something like that. And like every time there's a needle drop, which is a lot, it's a popular song of the time period. And I'm like, this sucks. It makes no sense. No sense. It's awful. Awful, awful, awful. I hated this movie. It was just terrible.
Now I've heard comparisons that it's like the Joker.
Well, I mean, sure, if you're trying to humanize a character who is best known for murdering puppies, and doesn't really have much of a story to begin with other than murdering puppies, and wanting to skin puppy Dalmatians to make a coat. And you probably heard by now that the opening of this movie is that she, as a child, a 10-year-old child, she witnesses her mother murdered by three Dalmatians.
I you serious?
Yeah.
Oh, boy.
But of course, it's all a misunderstanding, the reason behind that. So it's another angle to, you know, humanizing her and showing that, look, all of this is, I don't know, comes from some misguided place. It's, look, I can't even bother to spend any more time on this movie because it's just so bad. It's terrible. It's easily the worst movie of the year so far. I'll be hard pressed to find a worse movie unless I actively seek out a worse movie, you know? Bad guys, real bad. What is not bad is a movie that was released in the United States this year, and it stars Mads Mikkelsen, and it is called Riders of Justice. Riders of Justice is directed by Anders Thomas Jensen and also stars a bunch of Norwegian or Swedish names. I don't know where is Mads from anyways. Where is that? Norway?
Isn't he from Denmark?
Denmark, sure. Okay, fine. It's a Dutch film. I'll go with that. I'm taking your word for it, Wally. Point all blame at you if we're incorrect. Mads plays Marcus, who goes home to his teenage daughter, Mathilde, when his wife dies.
Osterboro, Denmark, baby.
Thank you. When his wife dies in a tragic train accident. It seems like an accident until a mathematics geek, who is also a fellow passenger on the train, and his two colleagues show up. This movie reminded me of like a Jeremy Saulnier film. Due to like the serious subject matter mixed with dark humor and ultra violence. It's actually a really compelling look at vengeance and guilt and grief and their effects on masculinity. Because what Mads plays is a soldier in the army, and he's overseas, and you can see, like, in his from his very first scene, he's very stoic and very serious, and there's no humor to him, and then all of the humor is played to the effect of the supporting cast, and that's where the dark humor comes into play in this, you know, very, you know, at times almost dour movie, and it just proves that Mads Mikkelsen continues to, you know, show us that he's really one of our all-time great working actors. Like, you want to look up professional actor, he'll be in the dictionary right next to like Gene Hackman and Willem Dafoe. You know, he's like in everything, and whatever they're in, they're great in. You know what I mean? And I like how his character also isn't just one note. You can tell there's like a lot of emotions just brimming under his surface, which shows itself really during some of the quieter moments, especially with his daughter. This is, I highly recommend this movie to both of you. I think you guys would really appreciate it, really like it. Obviously this is EA, but let me just have a gripe with Amazon here. So I go to select this to rent on Amazon, and it says English dub, and I'm like, huh. So I was like, well, is this intended to be English dubbed, or is that how the director made it or whatever? But no, it was in Dutch, and I was like, well, why is Amazon only presenting this as the English dub? So I go and look in other places, and sure enough, YouTube, for example, has the same film for rent, and it's available in its native language with English subtitles. Amazon did not offer that at all. And I'm like, what? This is 2021, and Amazon does not offer that as an option? That's ridiculous. Ridiculous. So if you're seeking this movie out, I recommend anything other than Amazon, because you obviously don't want to watch this in people's, you know, not native language. Anyways, yes, a high yay for Riders of Justice. This is a really, really good film. Hermano.
All right, I only watched one thing. I watched the recent, actually, I forget now. Is this Disney or Pixar? I think it's Pixar.
Yeah.
Luca?
Yes.
On the Italian Riviera, an unlikely but strong friendship grows between a human being and a sea monster disguised as a human. Not accurate, really, but kind of, I guess. So watch this for family night with the kids. They were really looking forward to it, seeing the trailers and all that. And Tim, you were just talking about mathematical equations. I have one of my own usually. Okay. When I watch these animated things with my kids, I take what I felt about the film. I add that to their reactions and how much they ask to rewatch it. And then I get the sum. And this one, I wasn't a big fan of it overall. I feel like it's two in a row now from Disney/Pixar where I feel like they don't seem as good as they used to be. I don't know if that's just me, but I feel like I will put a little asterisk near that too, because it could be pandemic related where they maybe had to sort of rush it out, or it was something where they couldn't really put the polish on it that they wanted to. So what I'm talking about is Raya and the Last Dragon and then this.
Yeah.
Because I did enjoy Soul for the most part, you know, and Onward has been on repeat in this house quite a bit. So I know the kids really, really like that one. In fact, they watched it today. And I also enjoyed that one. And that was probably the last one I would say I really enjoyed. But yeah, Luca, I wasn't a huge fan of the animation style overall. The story, it feels like they just kind of don't nail it. You know, like it seems like it's two thirds just kind of kids film. And then they try to have kind of the emotional core towards the end. And it feels like a little too late.
I've heard comparisons to Call Me By Your Name.
Yeah, I was wondering if this was kind of like a shadow gay love story.
I heard that. You know,
Disney's been
too
criticized for not overtly coming out and saying or stating that this is two, you know, gay characters and, you know, their relationship or whatever.
Well, you know why they can't overtly come out and say something like that? Because they have to market to China.
Yes, China. I knew that, but it does feel, you know, I wasn't 100% sure if that's where they were going with that, because it could also play as just, you know, a really close friendship. You know, it doesn't necessarily, to me at least, it felt like it was riding that line really tightly. Like it could go either way. But yeah, I just feel like they didn't nail it. Mia felt the same way. She felt like it was just kind of a mess. The kids, again, like they haven't really requested to see this again. Like, I don't know, you know, I didn't really get, you know, ask them straight out, like why, you know, they haven't, because usually they can't articulate it. It's just something, you know, they either like it or they don't, you know, at that age. So, yeah, like, I don't know. I feel like it's just weird. You know, I feel like Pixar was almost like a lock for putting out really good stuff, and maybe we're just spoiled and now they're putting out films that aren't quite as good, or and it just feels off somehow. So yeah, I don't know. It's not terrible. It's just not up there where I would say most Pixar films to me kind of straddle great to like really, you know, like almost like absolute classic, and this just feels like kind of like average for them. So kind of a mad to mild yay for Luca.
Morning, sleepyheads.
What the? Where are we?
We're in the studio.
Well, we've been in the studio the whole time.
I mean the real studio.
What do you mean? Oh, whoa. I'm dizzy.
That'll pass.
So many questions.
But you know which show you shouldn't pass?
The In Session Film Podcast.
That's right, Tim. The In Session Film Podcast is JD and Brendan.
Oh, if I wasn't so dizzy, I'd probably have something to say about Brendan.
Each week, the In Session Film Podcast chooses a movie to review,
then creates a top three list based on what they just saw.
This week, the In Session Film Podcast is reviewing Luca
and a top three list of coming-of-age films.
You can find their show on Apple Podcasts by searching for, you guessed it, the In Session Film Podcast.
Or on the web at insessionfilm.com.
So if you're looking for more great movie reviews and discussion,
then check out the In Session Film Podcast on Apple Podcasts.
or on the web at insessionfilm.com.
Yeah, I'm with you, Hermano. I have so many questions for Wally.
Let me get this straight. We were in the studio before, but we are in the studio now?
Yes, the real studio.
What does that even mean?
Hey, would you look at the time? Season's over.
Alright guys, so we need to record our top three reasons why you should listen to French Toast Sunday podcast.
Number three should definitely be our diverse opinions.
Number two should probably be our top three lists that we do every week.
No, it's gotta be Mark Wahlberg.
What about Gwyneth Paltrow's head?
It's gotta be fighting the sadness in the swamp of sadness.
Full frontal.
Stories about being lost at sea.
Brendan Fraser being underground.
Helen Mirren's boobs.
Baltimore accents as heard in The Wire.
Crepes? Character studies.
Wait, guys. What about movies?
No.
Tree rape.
Hmm.
Tree rape? Yeah, I like tree rape.
Tune in every Friday for a new episode of French Toast Sunday podcast brought to you by us at FrenchToastSunday.com.
This podcast is a proud member of the Lamb Podcasting Network. Find the network at largeassmovieblogs.com.
Okay, let's talk about True Romance.
He said that if I didn't get you on the phone, that he didn't want to do.
Hello, Lee. It's Clarence. Last we speak. Now, first of all, Lee, I want to tell you I'm a really big fan of yours. That's why I want to open Dr. Zhivago in L.A., and I need you and your abilities to distribute.
Clarence. I don't know, Clarence. Dr. Zhivago's a pretty big movie, you know?
Biggest movie you've ever dealt with, Lee. I mean, we're talking a lot of film here. A man would have to be an idiot not to be a little bit cautious about a movie like that. And Lee, you are no idiot.
No, I'm not saying I'm not interested, Clarence. It's just that being a distributor is not what I'm all about. I'm a movie producer, you know? I am on this earth to make good movies. Nothing more and nothing, well, maybe less sometimes. Hey! Choose a fucking lane! No, not you, just some idiot. Don't give me the finger! I'll fucking have you killed! Bottom line is, I am not paramount. You know what I'm saying? I got a select few distributors I deal with. I buy their little movies, and I accomplish what I want to accomplish, and I get the fuck out of there. Very businesslike and very easy, and very little risk, Clarence.
Lee, we're talking Dr. Zhivago here. This will be packing him in for a year and a half. 2 years. That is 2 years you're not going to have to deal with anybody else's movie but mine, all right?
Nobody's but yours. What is the rush here?
Oh, I just want to be able to announce this deal again, all right? If I had time for a courtship, Lee, I would. I'd take you out, I'd hold your hand, I'd kiss your cheek at the door. But I'm not in that position. I need to know right now if you and I are in bed together or not. If you want my movie, Lee, you're going to have to come to terms with your fear and desire.
The plot. In Detroit, a lonely pop culture geek marries a call girl, steals cocaine from her pimp, and tries to sell it in Hollywood. Meanwhile, the owners of the cocaine, the mob, track them down in an attempt to reclaim it. You know, just another Tuesday night for Wally. The director, Tony Scott. The actors, Christian Slater, Patricia Arquette, Dennis Hopper, Christopher Walken, and Gary Oldman. Wally, if I'm not mistaken, this is a first-time watch for you?
It is!
And?
No. I've heard so many good things about this movie, and none of it came true. This movie is Tony Scott. Or first off, I'm also going to say Tony Scott loves his silhouette love scenes. Okay,
oh, it's great. It's great.
But this movie, Tony Scott watched Wild at Heart, and thought he could do better. He thought, and that's what the problem with this movie is. This movie, it looks like he's trying to copy that same feel and same kind of mood and universe, and I think it's a complete swing and a miss. The pacing of this is absolutely atrocious, like how this movie is played out, because like, at the very beginning you have the two of them, and then not even 7 minutes later on screen they're a couple because they're clearly in love. And my first thought was like, this is where we're going to go for the rest of the movie. I can already see how this is gonna play out. There are certain scenes that that are you know, pretty good. But overall, this movie was a snooze fest for me. I did not care about anything that was going on. I was just sitting there on the couch, like, watching this going, all right, well, we're going to have to get from point A to point B with, here's Balky, and we're going to get from here to there with him, I suppose. The one thing I can take away from it is Gary Oldman is always amazing, no matter what he's doing. And so is James Gandolfini. James Gandolfini is terrifying. If he were still alive, and, you know, I've heard all these stories about him being such a great guy, but if he was mad at you, you would think you're going to die. He has that delivery in the scenes that he is in where you can actually feel it. All right, this is mortal danger. And in fact, during that scene, when we get to talking about it, I was actually quite surprised as to how that whole scene plays out. It didn't go the direction I thought it was going to go, given how the rest of the movie wants to play out. So overall, I can't say I was terribly high on this from the get-go.
If I'm not mistaken, James Gandolfini is in the movie 8mm with Nick Cage, right?
He is.
Yeah. He plays another kind of terrifying kind of guy, right?
Yep.
Like a heavy. Yeah. Romano, you had seen this movie at least once before?
Yeah, I'd seen it a couple times. Not in a long time. Mia asked me as well, and I told her I think the last time I saw this was probably like late 90s, probably. So there were elements of the film that I completely forgotten. Like, I couldn't remember even how the film ended. The only two standout scenes for me that I, you know, recalled very clearly was the Christopher Walken, Dennis Hopper scene. I remember feeling like that was the scene of the movie, basically, for me. Mm-hmm. And then I remembered Gary Oldman's performance because it was so wild and almost like chameleon-like, you know, for him to be playing a character like that. Weirdly, like, I remember my recollection of the film was that I really liked it. And but for whatever reason, I feel like I hadn't seen it a bunch of times. Like, I think I've only seen it maybe two or three times tops, and not in a long time. So, yeah, watching it this time, weirdly, I kind of feel the way Wally did. Like, I was like, wow, after it ended, I was like, I feel like I remembered liking this movie much more. I don't know if it was just, you know, I wasn't quite in the mood for it or whatever, but I just didn't come away, you know, feeling the same way I thought I had felt about it in the past. So I think it's Tony Scott for me. Like, I feel like the direction is not great. There are moments, like I said, the scene with Dennis Hopper and Christopher Walken, I think is amazing. I think that's mostly due to the writing. And speaking of writing, Quentin Tarantino wrote this, but I remember hearing that he was not a huge fan of the film overall. Like, he didn't like the way it turned out.
Considering what we know about Quentin Tarantino now, can you imagine how he would feel about anybody, no matter who it was, directing something he wrote?
Yeah, I mean,
that makes sense. It's never going to be as good as if I did it.
Right.
But, all right. Yes, probably now. But I feel like he said this even at the time.
Sure. I am sure he felt as confident about his abilities as a writer then as he does now.
Yeah. I just weirdly, like, I've kind of knocked Tarantino a little bit lately for some of his, like, really, like, his choices in his films where it's very dialogue heavy at times. It feels like someone who's really, like, just jerking themselves off to their writing, basically. Like, how long and drawn out a lot of his scenes are, and not always, as a positive for me. Like, I feel like I think he would have definitely made a better film overall with this material. I feel like this is a weird, this is like early Tony Scott too. So, you know, later in his career, he was a lot more about like this sort of like style.
Right.
He definitely adopted this sort of like cross between like a Michael Bay and like a music video type feel to his editing in his films, especially. Like, this feels so subdued comparatively. It's crazy, but almost like a totally indistinguishable as like anything he did later. Like, if I didn't know, I wouldn't know that Tony Scott directed this. It felt like anybody did.
Yeah, I think you can make a kind of a delineation between, like, from Man on Fire on and before Man on Fire.
Yes, yeah. Definitely. Yeah. But yeah, I mean, Christian Slater, I think, is doing his thing. He's totally doing the Christian Slater thing.
We need to talk about Christian Slater. Do you think he's right for this role?
No.
The way he's written, kind of. I mean, kind of like a movie. Like, it seems like Tarantino wrote himself basically into the character. Like, a guy who works at a comic store who's all about these, like, kung fu movie triple features and stuff. Like, it just feels like Quentin Tarantino writing himself, basically.
Right. I agree with you. He suits that side of the character, but he does not suit the action side, the Tony Scott side of the role at all.
He doesn't do anything that outrageous to me. Like, I mean, going in and just, you know, standing up to Gary Oldman's character. I mean, he just brings a gun.
That's,
it's not like he's
chugging
fat in that scene or anything.
That's still pretty outrageous considering you only know him as this manager of a comic books shop. And I don't understand where there's anything that would make me believe that he would ever have the balls to be able to do something like that.
The movie lost all believability to me because of what Wally already mentioned. Yeah. Like, their coming together is insane.
Yeah.
Like, yes. Absolutely insane. Like, the way she bumps into him, the whole circumstances revolving around why she's there, how she tells him that she loves him immediately.
Mm-hmm.
And then they get married basically, I think, what feels like the next day.
Yeah.
So, like, that right there already, I'm like, this is some fantasy world. Like, this is not.
And I could have accepted that if we had more time to build the relationship between the characters.
Don't you think that happens in real life anyways, that people get married on a whim like that? If, say, they fall in love with people on a whim like that?
Yeah, but anything those people do after, like, an event like that, I'm buying. Because they're clearly, there's no chill to them. Like, they're just, you know, they're flying by the seat of their pants. They're not, like, you know, following traditional, lengths for things, like, you know, oh, we're going to date for a year or, you know, really get to know each other. Like, they're just kind of making decisions and doing it. Like, it's weird. And then I don't know what Christian Slater's frame of mind is supposed to be, but he's having, like, I don't know if he's having, like, hallucinations or he's, like, schizophrenic or something. What? Like, I have no idea, but he's talking to Elvis.
What does Elvis have to do with any part of this movie at all?
He mentions, like, in passing that he's a big fan of Elvis. Okay. That's why he drives a big Cadillac.
Okay.
That's it.
But
it hasn't had much.
Yeah, I don't know what
I mean, it's weird. Like, I don't know. Like, Wally said, like, the characters aren't developed that well. So it just feels like kind of like this weird, I don't know. It's got a whole weird tinge to it, like, with everything the characters are doing. Like, I really felt like I just kind of settled into the, like, this is not real life. This is just some weird alternate reality.
I agree with some of the criticisms that you have, but you know what? I don't care. I actually loved this movie. And I think I had a similar opinion to you guys when I first saw this movie 15 years ago, 10 years ago. I don't know how when it was. And I'd only seen it that once. And I came away with it at the time kind of like mixed, you know, on it. And I'm like, huh, that was interesting, I guess. But on this watch, I was kind of blown away with all the choices because this movie has everything. Wally, I'm kind of stunned that you say that the pace of this movie isn't that good, because I don't think this movie ever stops. And
it doesn't. And that's part of the problem, that there's never a chance to breathe.
See, that's one thing I like about it, because it's one thing for a movie not to breathe and to be filled with moments that you don't care about. To me, I was intrigued in every single scene, basically either at the choices of Ridley Scott, of Quentin Tarantino, or of the actors themselves. There was always something interesting to me. And, you know, I love Tony Scott's signature, you know, like sweaty people in sweaty situations saying bad things while smoking in smoke-filled rooms. I think that's, you know, a pretty common staple of his movies. I love a choice like Bronson Pinchot getting a BJ while driving a Porsche. the Mexican standoff at the end, even as much as I criticize it, imaginary Elvis just thrown in for the hell of it. Gary Oldman as a one-eyed drug-dealing white Rastafarian pimp? Come on! That is amazing. You're right, Christopher Walken making the absolute most out of his one scene. And James Gandolfini and pothead Brad Pitt. This movie has everything in it. And look, it did take me a little while to warm up to the film. Like, you know, I think mostly because of Christian Slater. I don't think he's right for the role. I don't think he has a handle on Tarantino's dialogue very well. And when you mix that in with the kind of the machismo needed for a Tony Scott film, it just doesn't work that great. And, you know, you talk about Quentin Tarantino's dialogue. It's hard to divorce your feelings of his, you know, his writing at this stage of his career, where he clearly writes in racially insensitive dialogue just because he can and somehow is able to get away with it. You know, I'm glad, you know, he seems to have moved away from that in the later part of his career, and doesn't use it as a crutch for, like, shocking words over used by characters instead of just, like, you know, character-driven discourse. But I do love Patricia Arquette in this movie. I think she's great. Wally, what do you think about Patricia Arquette in this?
I mean, she's good at what she does, especially in that scene that she's got with James Gandolfini.
Right.
Like, she is totally believable. You know what I mean? And I think she does a fine job. I think that this, just the writing and how this whole story is paced out just really does this movie a disservice. Hmm. I think that's the biggest problem with this movie, because I, like you just alluded to, this is all elements of things that I like. It's just, for some reason, it doesn't work. And I think it has to do with how the whole story is just mapped out and how it all plays out as I'm watching it. There's not enough time to build. And even a movie like that I absolutely adore, Crank High Voltage, has some time to breathe in between scenes to get you reset for the next one. And this movie here just keeps going. And when you do that, you never really get a chance to get a full idea of the scope of what's happening and who's doing what now and where this person's coming from. And so I think that's the biggest flaw this movie has. That's where this movie turns wrong.
Well, Hermano, what did you think of Patricia Arquette?
I liked her. I definitely feel like she suited that role really well. Like, kind of like this weird kind of innocence to her. But I don't know. I liked her in the role overall. I think, like, the way she's written, her performance suited that character. I thought everyone was solid. Like, I think the way, you know, it's due mostly to the writing, though. I think everyone's dialogue in their moments, their scenes is really well done. I think the end, the Mexican standoff, where you say you like that.
Right.
It felt a bit sloppy to me.
Well, I agree with you.
It just felt like it. I don't know. I know that this is a different point in his filmography for Tony Scott, but I feel like even Quentin Tarantino would have made that scene more interesting. Like, it just felt like just everyone just kind of shooting, and, you know, it didn't, you know, I don't know. I just didn't really feel anything in that moment like I was supposed to. Like, even when, I don't know, are we doing spoilers for this?
We'll get to spoilers, yeah.
Okay. All right. I'll save that. But, yeah, and weirdly, as much as I'm, like, criticizing elements of the film, for a film that's 2 hours, it doesn't feel like a 2-hour film. Like, I feel like I watched it, and it all of a sudden it was over, and I'm like, oh, wow, weird. Like, I was already, you know, as soon as I saw the runtime, I'm like, ugh, 2 hours. And then all of a sudden it was over. I was like, oh, it didn't really feel like 2 hours. Yeah, it's weird. I don't know. It feels like, it must just be this viewing, because I do remember, like, each time that I've watched the film before, like, really enjoying it, and for you know, for different reasons and stuff. And for whatever reason, this time I'm just kind of like, yeah, I feel like I remember liking this more. And, like, you know, I forgot a large sections of the film. Like, I completely forgot how it resolved. I don't even remember how it began. Like, I was like, how did they meet again? And all of a sudden it happened so fast. I'm like, wow, is this really how they met? This feels so off. Like, but yeah, I don't know. I definitely will, you know, give another chance at some point, but for right now, it's just weird how all of a sudden I'm just kind of like, I don't know if this movie's that great.
It was nice to see Dennis Hopper in a more subdued role, and I think he suits you know, the fatherly figure pretty nicely. You know, even though they're essentially estranged relatives, I find that his connection and his chemistry with Christian Slater was nice. And then ultimately, you know, the scene with Christopher Walken proves touching in the end, if you will. You know, he's trying his best to protect his son. And it's, you know, as great as that scene is, I think that's the point where Tarantino infuses his own sensibilities in there. And to a degree that you're like, is it really necessary to put in these, you know, racial slurs, especially so much? Like, Wally, what did you think of how that scene played out?
I mean, I think it's played for shock value, because you've got, you know, the whole Dennis Hopper trying to protect his kid, and then basically he's trying to distract them. He's trying to take their mind off of what they're looking for. You know what I mean? He's aiming to kind of put more time on the clock, as it were, and so he starts telling the story about the eggplant, which is a common slur, especially if you watch The Sopranos, you'll hear that word bandied about a lot. You know, and also finding out after that, you know, that Tarantino had written it. Like, again, not surprising. But I really think that in this case, it's like whenever Tarantino drops one of those scenes in, it is always played for shock value. It doesn't really move the story along. It doesn't really add anything to it. It's there to make you go, oh, they're saying this, aren't they? You know what I mean?
Hermano, did you find this to also still be the best scene in the movie for you? Or is it Gary Oldman scene?
Gary Oldman is a close second, but for me, that scene is the scene of the film. Like, it's great because of, you know, the initial interaction, Christopher Walken giving that whole speech about how he's basically a human lie detector. And then, you know, Dennis Hopper just basically realizing he's not going to get himself out of this situation. So he basically throws it back in Christopher Walken's face and gives him this little history lesson, and then ends it with the line, "Now, if everything I just told you is a fact, am I lying?" I thought that was so great, like how, you know, that whole scene. And Christopher Walken's reaction, too. I mean, you know what's coming, but just his, like, initial reaction is great, too. Like, just kind of laughing it off and, you know, joking around there a little bit. And then how it ultimately ends is, you know, expected.
Yeah. Anything to mention before we get into spoilers?
I'm good for spoilers. I actually want to talk about the fight between James Gandolfini and Patricia Arquette.
Yes.
That was like the highlight of the movie for me. So actually the one time in the movie that I felt there were actual stakes, because it really does, the way it's played out, like, and what you've seen to this point of, you know, characters getting killed, you expect that it's going to go poorly, and then it turns on itself, and I would say it's one of the more brutal fights I've seen, you know, in film. And this I would say this movie is, as far as like its brutal scale, is up there with Endless Night.
Endless Night? Oh, you mean
longest night.
Sleepless Night.
Sleepless Night, that's the one. But I would say it's up there. I would say up there in terms of its brutality, like up there with the kitchen fight scene.
That's interesting.
Because like, yeah, I mean, like, Patricia Arquette's getting thrown through a glass shower. She's, you know, using whatever she's got nearby to be able to fight back, like just putting a bunch of soap in her hand and just like rubbing it in his eyes, and then like beating him down with the toilet seat lid. And she's been taking punches to the face prior to this the entire time. You know what I mean?
Mm.
And even the setup is great, where she's got, you know, she grabs the the corkscrew there, and it's like, You're expecting him to come close, and she's gonna maybe stab him in like the side of the head, and then he doesn't. He pulls the gun, and she just drops it into his foot, and like that's what sparks this whole thing. And then you get the Mexican standoff, which the thing is, like, I think this movie's also trying very hard to be a Better Tomorrow Part Two, which is what Christian Slater is also watching at one point in this movie, where there is, you know, just gunshots all over the place. There's bullets flying, because that's not really a I wouldn't say that's really a Tarantino staple. You know what I mean? These like long gunfights. Because like, even in Inglourious Basterds, the gunfights are really short and protracted.
Right.
You know?
Yeah.
But in this, it's really drawn out like they're trying to do a John Woo movie.
Well, yeah, no, it's clearly, this is probably one of the more interesting duos I've seen in a long time. When we talk about writing and directing, like you put Tony Scott as a director to Tarantino's writing, and it's just such an odd mix. I think I ultimately found it very compelling and very interesting and a really just good watch, fascinating watch. But I otherwise it's just such an odd duo. I think. Hermano, do you think that scene with Arquette is better than the Mexican standoff?
Oh yeah, for sure. Like that scene, like everything. I agree with everything Wally said. Like it's powerful. Like I mean, the only negative I would say is it feels almost comical how drawn out it is. Like James Gandolfini is like, I'm just gonna make every mistake in the book right now and give her every opportunity to kill me. You know, it's total movie cliche thing where it's like, oh no, she's down and out. Oh no, she's on the comeback. And then, you know, oh no, she's down and out again. Oh, she ultimately, you know, gets the upper hand or whatever. But overall, like Wally said, I think it is the scene that feels like it has the most stakes and feels like it's the closest it came to like, oh no, our heroes are in peril. but the standoff at the end, and I'll compare it to when I was saying earlier about like Quentin Tarantino would have done, obviously, I think a way better job handling his own material. Of course, it goes without saying, but that Mexican standoff. Now compare the one in this film to the one in Glorious Bastards.
I was just going to say that he has another one in his filmography. Yes, exactly.
Yeah. It's great. It's well done. I shit on that movie from time to time. And I continue to grow to like it each time I see it. But, yeah, compare that to this one. It feels really uninspired. Like it's just people just spraying wildly, and there's really nothing to it.
And that's what I'm saying. It's Tony Scott. That's Tony Scott right there.
Yeah, and I don't know. I really thought the tag on at the end too just felt kind of a little corny. You know, it felt unnecessary almost.
You mean on the beach and all that?
Yeah, yeah. I was like, yeah, really.
Okay. Yeah, I don't know. If it was directed a slightly differently, you could, you know, be led to believe that it's a fantasy or a dream sequence or something like that. But there isn't much there to be swayed otherwise than that it's just actually happened within the reality of the film. So wait a minute, Val Kilmer is in this movie as Mentor, and I have no idea who he is. I didn't see him. I don't recognize him. I don't know where he showed up in this movie.
Mentor.
Yeah.
Does he play Elvis?
Oh, interesting. I don't know because you never see his face, and he is in the credits within the film, and he's also an IMDb listed as Mentor. Interesting. I didn't even take into consideration that he might be Elvis.
I kept wondering. I didn't look it up. I meant to, but I kept wondering who if you know it was someone we knew, like, or is it just some random Elvis impersonator they got?
And then poor Samuel L. Jackson, still at this stage of his career, just barely gets any screen time. You know, I think he got more screen time in Goodfellas 3 years earlier than he did in this movie. You're right. You know what? I don't see any listing on here for Elvis, and I think you're right. I think he played Elvis. Holy shit.
Weird.
Huh. Interesting. Anything else to mention? We good? We're done? Okay, we're done.
I think we're good.
Well, Wally, what would you give this as a grade?
It's like a B- movie. I think that it's not that great. It's not terrible, but it's like that B-C+ range.
Interesting. I loved just about every minute of this movie. It took me a little bit to warm up to it, like I said. But, you know, I found this to be like a super violent version of Badlands by way of Jackie Brown and Thelma and Louise. So I really liked it. Solid A. Hermano.
Well, going into watching it this time, I feel like my recollection led me to believe that it probably would have been like an A or an A-. But after this viewing, I think I'm dropping it down to a B.
Wow. All right, that does it for this episode of the First Time Watchers podcast. Donate via patreon.com/firsttimewatchers or buy stuff at zazzle.com/firsttimewatchers.
Talk to us on Twitter at 1sttimewatchers on Twitter.
Or write to us at our email, firsttimewatchers@gmail.com.
Please leave a review for us on Apple Podcasts or Stitcher because we love feedback. If you have any suggestions of movies for us to watch, send a tweet or an email. Speaking of suggestions, let's recommend a movie. I'll go first. Yes, I will recommend another Tony Scott film, and it's from 1991, and it stars Bruce Willis and Damon Wayans. It's The Last Boy Scout.
Ain't that a bitch?
A movie that is super violent. And 1991, I was, when was this released? December. So I was 13 years old, and I went to go see this with my mother in the theater. because it was Bruce Willis. You know, Bruce Willis at his prime, right after Die Hard and Die Hard 2, really riding the high right there. And, taking on the action role with Shane Black writing, by the way. A private detective's protected female witness is murdered, prompting him and the victim's boyfriend to investigate the crime that leads to a corrupt politician and a cricket football team owner. Something only Tony Scott could direct, you know, with a wisecracking duo of Willis and Wayans, and I think there's an exploding football. I think there is. I don't know. It's a good time.
A jig.
What's that?
It's also a jig.
What does that mean?
There's a dance in it. There's a dance scene. Oh. So if I survive this, I'm doing a jig.
I gotcha. Very good. I recommend The Last Boy Scout. Wally.
All right. I'm going to recommend the movie I alluded to at the very beginning. This movie, I think, is trying very hard to be like. That's 1990s Wild at Heart. Young sailors, Sailor and Lula, run away from the variety of weirdos that Lula's mom has hired to kill Sailor. Directed by David Lynch, starring Nicolas Cage, Laura Dern, and Willem Dafoe. And looking to see if we have actually done an episode on this, it doesn't look like we have.
We have not.
We've talked about it. We've talked about it several times over the course of this podcast on multiple episodes, 167, 314, and even before that. So it's got some traction. So I'm going to say you probably should watch this.
Agreed. Hermano.
All right. My connection is another film that I feel like I remember liking quite a bit, but I just rewatched it within the last week or so, and I didn't even finish it. And maybe I'm just in a mood because I remember really liking this film, too. And I think I've heard Wally in the past say he's not a huge fan. From David Fincher, Fight Club.
Wow.
Well, you're not a fan, right?
Overrated.
Yeah. After this viewing, I wouldn't say overrated. But as it was progressing, I don't know why, but this time I really felt the kind of cruel nature of it all, like with character actions and just the dialogue, and it just felt almost like I don't know if I could be completely missing the point. I don't know. I never read the book or anything like that, but it just felt like overly insensitive and cruel. And again, like I said, it could be totally that I'm in some sort of weird mood where like I'm revisiting things and I'm just kind of like looking at them through maybe a more, I don't know, like adult lens or something. I don't know.
I rewatched this movie in August of 2018 and I felt very similarly to you. I had very fond, you know, fond memories and high expectations going into my revisit. And I found that I wasn't entirely sure if Fincher was taking the material and praising it or criticizing the actions of the people. You know what I mean? Like there's a core of commenting on the facades people put up in certain situations, but it goes off in wild tangents, you know, like of anarchism that I'm not sure really knows exactly what it wants to say, you know, and that could be the point, you know, but I don't know. I was sad, you know, on that revisit.
Yeah, it was a lot of ups and downs for me because there were still moments that I enjoyed overall. But yeah, just a weird feeling to be like, wow, how come I didn't enjoy this as much as I feel like I've enjoyed it in the past? So I guess I'm sort of, again, I'm going to watch it again. Of course, it's David Fincher. I'm always a fan of his. But yeah, just a weird viewing experience this past time, but still kind of recommending it.
All right, stay tuned for our next episode. We will return at the end of August for season 2 of 2021. Not sure what movie yet, but I'm sure it will be very interesting.
That's the First Time Watchers podcast because we like to watch.
crazy, but I love to hear you preach. All around the world, from London to Japan, still can't quite explain it, but little does they understand. Yes, I live in Graceland, never took that trip.
I'm going to New York City on Friday.
I was pretty close to there a couple days ago.
Why? What? Where?
I went to Connecticut.
Well, how close were you to New York City, though?
I guess not that close.
Yeah. Connecticut's a pretty big place. So, you know, there's a lot of emptiness in Connecticut, you know, and highway, too. There's a lot of highway in Connecticut.
Oh, yes. You can say that again. Yeah. Doing the Times Square thing and all that.
Well, we're literally staying in Times Square.
Yeah, you told me that.
Going from there, like, have you heard of the Museum of the Moving Image, MOMI?
Yes.
We're going there on Friday afternoon. And then, because they just opened up within the past couple of weeks, they reopened. What are we doing? We're going to, you know, Ellis Island, Statue of Liberty. And then we're going to One World Trade Center, Freedom Tower, and going up to the 101st floor there, and then on Sunday we're meeting up with a Slack friend who I've never met in person, so who lives in the city, so it'll be cool.
Nice.
Yeah, I think it'll be fun. Getting, I'm all packed up.
How many days?
Going on Friday morning and coming back Sunday night. Two nights right in Times Square. It'll be fun because, like, if we get bored, like at midnight or something like that, just walk outside.
Yeah.